in January as compared to 7.5% in the same period a year ago. The retail inflation has risen, we understand, to 2.57% in February as against 1.97% in January. Now, the number that we should actually look at is the IIP number. This is industrial production. The industrial production number having gone down to less than 2%. If we compare that to where it was in the month of December, where it was 2.8%, that is a decline. So the argument that the government gives us about jobs would be linked to how much we're producing through our industry. And that's a story we'll track very closely for you. But there is a story I do want to share with you before we go on to our main conversation for this evening. A month ago, you'll remember, Mira and I visited the Dharavi Transit Camp School. And we found it in absolutely pathetic condition, exposing the realities of the BMC-run schools. Now, we investigated how children were denied basic facilities. They were made to sit on the floor. The classrooms were being clubbed, compromising the quality of education. We raised that issue. We followed it up with the BMC. We insisted they take action. Now, the BMC promised us that action would be taken. And we've done a follow-up ground check today. We found that our coverage has woken up the authorities. The children now have been provided with benches to sit on. The school, which lacked basic amenities, now has computers and science labs for the students. My colleague Disha Shah joins me live right now. Disha is the one who did that story, and we're very proud of the result. Disha, so first of all, congratulations for making an impact to the lives of these children. But did you see, was it just a couple of classrooms and benches? Because I do recall that there were several other problems in this school.
Well, that's right, Faye. Here we are talking about one of the biggest schools in the heart of Mumbai, the Dharavi Transit Camp School, with a student capacity of over 6,000. So as you rightly pointed out, that in the first week of February this year, we had visited the school and we investigated that how children were forced to study in pathetic conditions. What a school really need? Basic facilities like benches, that was also not really available for the children, and most of them were forced to sit on the floor. A month later, we revisited the school, Faye, and actually we took the tour of the entire school to see if there are any changes on the ground level, like how the BMC had assured and promised us on 12th of February this year. So to our surprise, we revisited the same classes that we had investigated last time, and we saw a tremendous change and progress on the ground, Faye. We saw that children were not sitting on the floor, but they had benches to sit on. No more classrooms were being taken in corridors or playground, but in proper classes. Second important discrepancy that we highlighted was the fact that how two classes were clubbed in one with a student capacity of over 80. But today what we saw was that there were only 40 students in one class and one teacher teaching only one division. So to our surprise, when we also interacted with the students, they told us that this change has taken over in the last 20 days or so. Third aspect, Faye, what we really highlighted was the fact that how one entire Urdu medium section, the 9th standard, was made to study on the corridor, which they were being forced to do so for the last 1 year. But today what we saw, at least 4 classes have been designated for Urdu medium alone. So all of these changes we have seen. And lastly, Faye, the computer and the science lab, which was not at all operational or available for the secondary section, they have now made it available, at least. So for secondary students, science labs and computer labs is something that they are learning at this point in time. And other issues like water problem, the hygiene problem, all of it, what we saw there, especially in the girls' toilet, it was really clean. And we saw that how there were workers working, at least in the 2 hours of time when we were there. So we saw tremendous amount of change, Faye. But the biggest question here is that in the last year, there were about 277 crore rupees, the budget which was allocated, but only 30% of amount was used. So today what we saw was a big mirror now impact, but the question is that big schools also should really follow the same lead.
All right, Disha, many thanks for bringing us that story. And of course, everything will hinge on the government's ability to maintain that quality. And we'll continue to check not just the schools in Mumbai, but schools across the country to make sure that the quality of our education that we're giving our students and our children doesn't suffer. We're moving on to the topic of discussion today. We do know that the centre went ahead with demonetisation despite the RBI board cautioning the government that none of their purposes would be met. Why did the government do it anyway? Take a look.
8 नवंबर 2016 की रात्रि को 12 बजे से वर्तमान में जारी 500 रुपए और 1000 रुपए के करेंसी नोट लीगल टेंडर नहीं रहेंगे.
The announcement that disrupted lives of every single citizen of the nation. Minutes of the RBI board meet before demonetization reveal the central bank and board members had reportedly warned the Modi government about the impact of demonetization. The minutes of this meeting, accessed by Mirror Now, detailed discussions of the negative short-term impact and doubts over meeting the intended goals.
It goes on to record as to how demonetization would ensure a dip in the GDP, alongside noting as to how there was a purported currency, fake currency in circulation of 400 crores, which was not that high in quantum to have undertaken demonetization as an exercise.
All through, the government has maintained that there were three main objectives to demonetization: curbing black money, flushing out counterfeit notes, and ending terror financing. The minutes of this board meet show that RBI board had observed demonetization will not have any material impact on black money and that the volume of counterfeit notes in circulation was not very significant. Additionally, minutes show that the board felt demonetization will have a negative effect on the GDP. Now, multiple reports from the RBI and government show that the board's warnings turned out to be true. In August 2018, RBI reported that 99% of the demonetized money was returned, counterfeit notes though continued to be circulated, and terror funding and terrorism continue to plague India. Mirror Now asks, will the centre concede that demonetization was a failure? Why did the centre not pay attention to RBI's board warnings? Let's debate.
But before I bring in my entire panel, and the question to ask is simply this: if the RBI very clearly 3 hours before the government announced demonetization cautioned the government that this will not work and it will have in fact an adverse impact on the economy and on citizens, why did the government go ahead with that decision? R.S. Gandhi, former deputy governor of the RBI, is with me on the show. So is Vivek Kaul, who's a very senior journalist who's examined the matter of demonetization and the Indian economy very closely. Mr. Gandhi, good evening and thank you for joining us. You've obviously taken a look at the minutes of the meeting. Would you say the government went ahead despite caution issued by its very own experts in the RBI? Because the RBI is, or the board are the foremost experts that are meant to consult the government on these matters.
Yes, for public on public policy matters, government, and especially relating to finance, government does consult the Reserve Bank, Reserve Bank's board in this particular case. And Reserve Bank board has deliberated on it and had given its observations, comments, and expressed certain reservations also. So in matters of public policy, there has never been any policy which is singularly, completely beneficial. There will always be by aspects which may have a negative impact on certain segments or certain sectors of the economy. And when policies are made, the experts will have to make those comments upfront so that everybody upfront clearly knows what is the likely impact, negative impact in respect of such policies. So as by Reserve Bank being a professional body, it had given such observations to the government. And ultimately, this particular decision is at the government. So government had taken that decision to go ahead even after listening to and understanding the Reserve Bank's comments. And probably they would have thought that this can be by certain negative aspects or only the short term. In the medium term, that can be corrected. Other kind of safeguards can be brought on. So that's the way typically public policy happens. So in this case also, despite Reserve Bank's certain observation, my government went ahead.
Vivek, when you looked at the minutes of the meeting, and some of it is fairly strongly worded, does it suggest to you that the government gave the Reserve Bank board enough time? Because we know this meeting happened at 5, the announcement happened at 8.
I mean, if you take that into account, it's very clear that the government had already made its decision. And if you look at the Modi government, once they sort of make a decision, they are very brazen about implementing it. I mean, they really don't bother about the other formalities which stand in the way. So,
and the quality of the decision, because we do, I mean, in the meeting it says that the board has been assured that this matter has been under discussion between central government and RBI for the last 6 months, and basically most of the things you're worried about will be looked after. Don't worry, we're just going to go ahead and do this.
Yeah, but see, you know, the most basic thing which is not there, you know, in this RTI reply, is the fact that money ultimately, paper money ultimately, has no value of its own. It's basically a medium of exchange. Now, the moment you take out 86% of the paper money out of an economy, I mean, any economy, it need not be India, it's, you know, obviously economic transactions will collapse. I mean, it's not rocket science at the end of the day. So, once you take that into account, all the other, everything else follows. I mean, you take the fact that, the entire talk about black money. Now, in 2012 May, the government had released a white paper on black money, okay?
Yes.
And it had some very interesting data which the Income Tax Department put out, wherein they said that during search and seizure operations, which is basically a euphemism they use for income tax raids, only around 4.9% of the unaccounted wealth which they found was held in the form of cash.
Yes.
So, which basically means that people hold black money, as we call it, in the form of real estate, gold, or it simply leaves the country. I mean, as Nirav Modi in London suggests so.
And he's used a lot of that money to buy that ghastly jacket though, which we must point out. But let me just point out what the RBI has said, echoing what Vivek just pointed out. It has said significant observations were made by the directors of the RBI. One, it is a commendable measure, but it will have a short-term negative effect on the GDP for the current year. It goes on to say that your calculation has not adjusted for inflation, so the actual difference is not that stark. Any incidence of counterfeiting is a concern, but ₹400 crore as a percentage of the total currency is not significant enough to merit this decision. Most black money is held not in cash, but in the real estate sector or in gold, so this move will have no impact. So basically, would it be safe then to assume, Mr. R.S. Gandhi, to say that A, the government had received enough and adequate warning from its own RBI board on the adverse impact of demonetization as a decision? And you said yourself, it's the RBI's job to give an opinion and then the government makes that decision. Do you believe the government made the right decision, Mr. Gandhi?
Yeah, the RBI board has certainly given its views about the negative side of the demonetization proposal. And ultimately, government must have weighed on both the sides about the demerits and merits of introducing it, and finally it had gone ahead. Whether it has been the right decision or not, history will, of course, record that. And even at that time also, and many times thereafter, I have mentioned that benefits of demonetization can be measured only after medium term. 3 to 5 years, the benefits to flow, one has to completely wait. So we may not be able to make a judgment based on the immediate negative effects, which everyone has conceded. Nobody, even the government, did not say that there will not be any negative impact on the economy in the short-term period. Whether that price that paid in terms of a reduction in the economic growth and certain sectors being affected badly compared to other sectors, whether it is the right price to be paid for the benefits that is likely to come, we have to wait for the final judgment, as I said, between 3 to 5 years. The tax compliance, what is the major objective of eliminating or reducing the incidence of black money? the tax compliance should increase, tax to GDP ratio should be increasing. So that that to happen, already say by in the last 3 years since demonetization, we are seeing an upward trend in that respect. Obviously, the researchers will come out and will be able to establish what is the contribution of the demonetization for such impact. That we need to be waiting for the final call.
Vivek, obviously, if I ask you the negative impact of demonetization, that's the whole show. Yeah. Were there any positives that came out of it?
I mean, no. I mean, I wouldn't look at it like that. Because
what about tax compliance?
Compliance, you know, first, I think the first point, I just responding to Mr. Gandhi, you know, I would like to make is that, you know, as a former deputy governor of RBI, I mean, he needs to be euphemistic. So. So you have to take that into account while you know, taking his answers. The good point about, you know, tax compliance going up is you know, can really be challenged, because, you know, if you look at the fact that in the last few years the stock market has really done well. Now I'll give you a parallel example of the tax to GDP ratio going up between 2005 and 2008.
Yes.
When the stock market was doing very well, and obviously and in 2009 2010 the ratio collapsed. And that was primarily because a lot of people were trading on the stock market, and hence they were paying a short-term capital gains
because
tax.
Because you can't trade black money on the stock market. Yes.
So along similar lines, something like that could have happened, you know, in the last few years as well. The other point that people don't realize about tax collection is that, mm-hmm. you know, even if you look at the GDP, the government GDP data, which is highly suspect, the economic growth has fallen from, you know, higher than 8%
yes.
to less than 7%. Now, if in this environment the government is collecting more tax as it claims to, I mean, there is something of a problem. You know, when the economy is economic growth is falling and tax collections are going up, there is a severe problem somewhere.
I also want to point out that the government did not list increased tax compliance as
yes.
one of its reasons.
It wasn't there
scheme of things. It was brought in later. And even
yes.
so, the Seventh Pay Commission increased the number of people who had to file taxes and who had to pay taxes. And we've seen the actual increase in a lot of places in a lot of years is among the salaried class.
Yeah, and so the interesting part is, just because more people are filing taxes, it does not mean more people are paying taxes. So this is something that
yes.
you know, also needs
and
to be taken into
and
account.
And an increase in salaried class paying tax is not an increase in tax compliance
anything.
Because there's no black money in the
yeah.
salaried class
so
anyway.
In fact, you know, one last point I'd like to make is that there are just 81,344 individuals in India who have a gross income of greater than 1 crore as per the Income Tax Department.
Yes.
So that in itself tells you that, you know, we might go gaga over a lot of things on demonetization, but that gives you the real picture of how, you know,
yes.
the number of people paying tax in India is very few. So,
well, Mr. Gandhi, I know you have to leave. So one quick question before you go. Do you believe that the advice given by the RBI was heeded to? Do you believe the RBI board was given enough time to consider a decision of this size? Do you think the government did right by the RBI board in this case?
First of all, you yourself have mentioned the number of comments and the serious comments that the RBI board had made on the proposal. That itself brings out the fact that RBI board has applied its mind, even though the time given was very short, but they were able to analyze the proposal and compare it with whatever possible impact that it may have. So the board has been sagacious in terms of arriving at a conclusion. Even though by the time, as you would say, that two or three hours or whatever is insufficient, but within that time itself, it had come out with significant
yes.
observations. So that shows that it has done its duty very well. And two quick points I wanted to make that demonetization had other objectives. One is elimination tackling the black money. The other is about tackling the counterfeiting. So counterfeiting in these 3 years, of course, is too early also, because a completely new set of notes have been brought on. It is not easy for any counterfeiter to simply copy that. Yes, the crude counterfeiting like photocopying and other thing that has happened, that will ever happen. So that is not the real counterfeiting. But the serious counterfeiting which we had seen prior to this, that has not happened at all. And that is unlikely to happen because of a completely new series have come on at one go and all the old series have been withdrawn. So that benefit definitely has accrued to the country.
Yes. And of course,
one
the
more
last
point, the, had there not been demonetization, the level of
Go ahead, Mr. Yeah.
The level of cash in the economy would have been much, much higher than what, see, the level of cash that is in the economy, had there not been demonetization, would have been something like 25 lakh crores or whatever. And today, actually, it is 20 lakh crores. So that means that there is a reduction of 5 lakh crores of cash that has been financialized, so to say. The cash which was would have been otherwise there, that is now been in the form of financial assets or other real assets. That is another benefit of demonetization.
All right, Mr. Gandhi, many thanks for joining us on the show. Just to bring in the rest of our panel, Vivek Reddy, spokesperson for the BJP. Ashutosh is a senior journalist. Professor Arun Kumar is the chair professor at the Indian Institute of Social Sciences. We also have with us Akash Jindal, an economist. Ajay Dua, former commerce secretary. And of course, Vivek Kaul, who stays with us. I thank all of you for joining us on the show. I'm going to open this up right now to the panel, one by one, so everyone has an opportunity to make their arguments. Ashutosh, I will come to you. Of course, as a journalist, and I'm sure Vivek will agree with me, these daily stories that we did during demonetization, I mean, were shocking for us. And the anecdotal stories that came in from friends and family of what was happening outside every bank was just unbelievable. But to now find out that the government, now we can safely say, ignored the advice of the RBI and went ahead and did this anyway, basically means that all fallout of the demonetization decision stands with the government and not with the RBI. Ashutosh.
See, Faye, I think what the Prime Minister spelt out on that particular day, that why the demonetization was done to tackle basically three things: the black money, the drug, and the, if I remember correctly, it was terror funding and the counterfeiting, the four. Still, I think there is no check on these things. And so what was the real reason behind the demonetization? I think that still need to come out. And what was most baffling was that even after demonetization, when the question were asked how much money had come back to the exchequer, nobody was ever told. Even the parliament committee was asking questions to Urjit Patel, and even Urjit Patel was not in a position to tell exactly what has happened. And finally, I'm being told that he has resigned from the RBI because of the demonetization, though he never spelled out, but my sources have told me so. So it has been a very, very mysterious, baffling exercise, in my opinion. First of all, what was spelled out had never happened. Terror is still a reality. The counterfeiting is still a reality. The black money is still a reality. If anybody says the black money is completely wiped out from the system, I'm not going to believe that.
Okay.
So the real reason has to be ascertained, and I hope someday the truth will really come out.
Mr. Ajay Dua is the former commerce secretary. Mr. Dua, thank you for joining us and good evening to you. Did you find the minutes of the RBI meeting worrying? Because the RBI board effectively predicted what would happen with this decision, and that prediction was ignored.
Certainly, the minutes of the meeting which you've been able to get through the RTI is a matter of concern that the federal government or the central government chose to ignore the views of the RBI, which is the body kind of given the responsibility of running the monetary policy of the country. However, Faye, I think the RBI cannot be pleading that they were not aware of what was happening, because after all, some amount of logistics arrangements had been made by the RBI, because very next morning, trucks and had been used by it to send out new currency notes. So some notes were ready. But what also bothers me a bit, and I should call it a bit, is that the concerns expressed by the RBI are more by way of like any conservative body with most federal banks are, a conservative department of the government, where it's not opposed in any sense of the word that the government should not go ahead with demonetization, but has pointed out a few difficulties and the fact that the consequences in black money curving would not be as much as the government.
Mr. Dua, as a former bureaucrat yourself, would you say that this is commonplace in government offices to mildly caution but not actually stand up to the government?
I think it varies from a person to person in the government. This was if the RBI felt so strongly about it that 86% of the money was to become illegal tender within 6 hours of its meeting ending, then certainly it should have pointed out to the government what the consequences would be, and it was not, as we all know, mildly upsetting the economy, but it was virtually for several weeks derailing the economy, where the most vulnerable persons, that means the daily wagers, the farmers, the farm labor, as well as those working in the organized sector, but not on the formal record of.
Yes. In fact, the medium term was a derailing of the economy. The short term was a derailing of people's lives. They were senior citizens who were extremely inconvenienced. Farmers, like you said, daily wagers who just simply couldn't go on with basic day-to-day life. There has to be accountability for why that decision was made. Vivek Reddy of the BJP joins us now. Vivek Reddy, demonetization has fallen off the cart of the government's achievements. You barely mention it now that we're in election season. Is it a bad dream that you wish never happened?
I don't think so. The Prime Minister's tweet in November 2018, which is hardly 3 months ago, JFA, says that the Congress is questioning demonetization because it has taken such radical steps which led to the crackdown of several shell companies. And the number of shell companies which have been cracked down is up to 3 lakhs.
But Vivek Kaul, Vivek Reddy, you did not place before the RBI that your aim of demonetization was to crack down on shell companies. That was not the declared aim, and you can't keep changing the goalposts.
Which is black money.
Which shell black companies money. Was this theory which was brought in
which
later.
Black much later.
Cracking down on shell companies.
It had nothing to do with demonetization. If you wanted to tackle shell companies, you could have done that.
Ultimately, let me just complete, please.
Vivek, here's the thing. Shell companies, if they did exist, there is the Companies Act. They're all registered or they have to have bank accounts. Yes. It's very easy to find them and crack down if that's the aim.
Have to demonetize 86% of the nation's currency to crack down on shell companies. I mean, that was one of these theories which was brought in later along with the digitization of the economy. So,
let's not forget that there's no acknowledgement of the 100 people who did die. Nobody has even bothered
to investigate and make a list. Let me just clarify. Second issue.
Go ahead.
Do you know that there are 3 lakhs companies which are closed? First one. Kindly look at the second. The second issue is about 13.54 lakh accounts in India, which had holded about 2.668 lakh crores. 13.54 lakh accounts holding about 2.68 lakh crores. These account holders, even today, have been unable to explain satisfactorily where they got the money, what was the source. And therefore, these account amounts are suspect. So, what is the total exposure?
The exposure is
2.68 lakh crores.
How many people have been prosecuted with this new evidence that you have received?
15 lakh crores, and it is 2.68 lakh crores.
Mr. Reddy.
Yes.
How many people have gone to jail?
What did you say?
How many people have gone to jail because of this new evidence you have received? How many? After the election.
All these are suspect accounts.
Mr. Reddy, will the government of India and the BJP acknowledge the 100 people who died during demonetization? Will you apologize to those families? Will you apologize to the 100 families who lost loved ones?
No, come on, Faye. Come on, please.
What do you mean, come on, Faye? Come on.
Please.
I'm very serious.
Let me tell you, Faye, No, I don't understand. I don't understand your thesis, Faye. I mean, the sort of narrative that you're putting out.
It was a
question.
I don't
really understand it.
Will the government apologize to the 100 families who lost loved ones during demonetization?
If the tax collections... No, I really don't understand the sort of narrative that you're putting forth. There are bound to be some serious repercussions.
Yes, to be serious repercussions.
Are very precious. It cannot be lost. Yes, it cannot be lost. There are bound to be serious repercussions. But look at the large-scale impact on the economy. Look at the large-scale impact on the economy. I wonder, I really don't know. I really don't understand, Faye. You are prone to take certain incidents and you exaggerate them.
Mr. Reddy, give me Mr. Reddy, please.
I don't think that is the right approach.
Mr. Reddy, please tell me how one exaggerates the death of 100 innocent citizens.
These are the advantages.
How do you exaggerate the death? One second. All right. I heard you out. I heard you out.
You have to hear me out also.
No, I've heard you out.
Yes.
You suggested, Mr. Reddy.
Can you also tell me, Faye?
Mr. Reddy, you have to stop talking to be able to hear my question.
The amount of tax collection prior to demonetization was 8 lakh crore. Today, it is 15 lakh crore.
It doesn't matter. It that was not one of the aims collection. Of demonetization.
Demonetization and GST
nope.
has led to doubling of tax. What do you mean doesn't matter?
No.
India has...
That is not one of the aims declared for demonetization. Mr. Reddy is obviously not willing to listen to any of the answers. Let's move on to the other panelists. I do want to point out, if there is anyone watching...
Let me tell you, when a country has...
All right. I do want to apologize to anyone who's watching right now who might have known someone who passed away or lost a loved one at that time. I do not believe it's possible for one to exaggerate the death of 100 innocent citizens. I do believe it's something as a country we should acknowledge and we should perhaps also apologize for. There are two panelists who haven't spoken yet, Professor Arun Kumar and Akash Jindal. Akash Jindal, you first. Do you believe that the government should have paid attention to the RBI's warning?
Firstly, lots of congratulations for winning the Top Editor Award. I think it was 15th February, but this is my first show after you since then.
Thank you, Mr.
I mean, it's lovely to be on a platform which is getting so much of recognition and respect. Now, as far as demonetization is concerned, I'll take you back to the RBI report. What I've made out is that RBI is perhaps saying that black money exists in two forms, one in real estate, one in gold. Now, whenever I have talked about demonetization, I have always spoken demonetization and the follow-up action. If you see the follow-up action, the government has capped cash transactions, whether it's real estate, whether it's gold. So those people who were into the illegal business of using black money, now they have been penalized. Who had illegal black money assets in gold or real estate, they can't exit it. So the black money people have already... already been impacted. They have already been penalized. Now, coming again to the GDP growth, yes, for the short term we were impacted, but as of now, the World Bank says 7.3% GDP growth. That's a January 2019 report for this fiscal 18-19, and for the coming 2 years, they're talking about 7.5% growth rate. International agencies say globally, we are into a state of gloom, and globally the GDP growth has been downgraded to 3.3%. China, they have de-escalated from 6.5% to 6%.
So you're saying our
Japan,
growth has
the third biggest
intact.
Economy, they had a one quarter negative.
Yes.
So growth is okay, except for the jobs issue. I mean, BJP has to answer
the
on the jobs
fastest
issue.
Fastest growing economy in the world.
As far as jobs are concerned, but... I'm talking about, sir, but where the jobs issue, I mean, you have lot to answer about that. Let me also bring in
a Professor Arun Kumar, please, if I may. Professor Arun Kumar, here's the thing, and I will ask Vivek to comment on this as well. The revised GDP data tells us that we actually grew at 8.2% during demonetization, when demonetization was happening to us. Now, this caused a large number of people to question the GDP data at all. Do you agree that growth was not affected? Do you believe and agree that the government did the right thing because tax compliance improved and that's what makes it okay?
So, Faye, what I'd like to say is that the GDP data has a lot of problem.
When the government says that we don't have employment figures, then how do they estimate the unorganized sector? Because you require the employment figures to estimate the unorganized sector. And the data for the unorganized sector comes once every 5 years when you do surveys. So the assumption is that the unorganized sector is growing at the same rate as the organized sector. That assumption was true before November 8th, but not after November 8th, where the unorganized sector unambiguously declined. The organized sector was still rising, perhaps. So in other words, the methodology had to be changed. And that's why my argument has been that the rate of growth of the economy is not 7%. If you include the decline in the unorganized sector, which is shown by data from All India Manufacturers Organization, from the Punjab, Haryana, Delhi Chamber of Commerce and Industry, etc., then the rate of growth is less than 1% today. And the World Bank does not collect independent data. The World Bank only reproduces the government's data, and that's why it will say what the government is saying. Therefore, World Bank is not an independent data collection agency. It cannot collect the data independently, and that's why that would not work. However, coming back to the RBI's issue, it's good that we now have the minutes, because earlier it was said that the RBI board met in the morning. Now we know it met at 5:30. Earlier it was said that the meeting took place in the morning and it was recommended, and then the RBI governor went back and met the bank managers. But now we know what the truth is. But the important point is that here it did not give in writing that the demonetization should not be done. In 1978, IG Patel, who was the governor then, gave in writing. When only 0.6% of the notes were high denomination note, he said that this will not solve the problem of black economy. Yes. It will create problems in the economy as a whole. The second point is that the discussions were going on with RBI for 6 months. In the 6 months period, the RBI should have made a complete analysis of the impact that demonetization would have on the thing. It should have also made an analysis of how much counterfeit currency there existed. Unfortunately, the RBI did not do that. And finally, if the RBI thought it was negative, I think it should not have given the go-ahead to the government, because that gave the sort of fig leaf to the government to go ahead with the decision which they had already made. So in effect, what I'm saying is, while it's good that the RBI made certain points about the ill effects of it, but it did not go far enough to say it should not be done. It did not give in writing, it should not be done. If it had given in writing, that would have been a very different matter altogether.
Yes,
the
Professor.
The final point I'd like to make is that the unorganized sector, which operates in cash, that has been damaged very severely. And the idea that cash means black, that was underlying the idea of demonetization. That is not true. And I see the confusion in the RBI's report when it says black money is held in the form of real estate, etc. Actually, it's black wealth. And black money is only one component of that. So RBI is again making a mistake, the same mistake that the government made in the 2012 white paper where it called black money. And real estate is not the generator of black incomes. It is a circulator of black income. That's a mistake made in the 2012 report of the government of India. That's also the mistake that we made.
Despite all this, India is the fastest growing economy in the world.
That have been made.
For all your long stories, sir.
No,
India is
not
the fastest growing
economy
in the world, number one.
Mr. Reddy, I will thank you to treat my panelists with respect.
The unorganized sector has been declining rapidly as per the data given by all different agencies.
All right, just wait for me to come to you, please. Gentlemen, don't speak over each other. My question, just one moment.
Because the World Bank is saying the rate of growth is 7%, this is not correct.
This argument of we are the fastest growing economy in India, and Vivek Reddy actually saying, despite all of this, why does it have to be despite? Why did we create a man-made hurdle that we would have to trip over and then still do well?
In fact, I would like to rephrase what Vivek Reddy has been saying. India is not the fastest growing economy in the world. India is the fastest growing large economy in the world. So there is an important distinction that needs to be made. Then there is this bit about China, right? Now, we need to take into account the fact that China is a $10 trillion economy and we are $2.6 trillion. Mm. So, even if China grows a few basis points slower than we do, like, you know, in 2017, China grew by around some 6%. It added 1/4 of the Indian GDP to its economy. It's that big. So, you know, you have to take into account the fact that as an economy grows bigger and bigger, its economic growth is bound to get slower. But at $10 trillion, if China is still growing at 6%, it's a huge achievement. I mean, at $2.5 trillion, we are finding it difficult to grow at even 7%.
Yes.
So that is a, you know, I don't find any BJP spokesperson making that point.
This is the thing we should caution our viewers about. Demonetization had three specific goals.
Yes.
And through the course of that demonetization process, we saw the goal change to digitization. We saw the goal change to opening more bank accounts. Everything. We saw the goal change to a lot of different things. But we have to, in order to be able to properly assess the success or failure, success or failure of any government move, we have to stick to the original goals.
In fact, I want to just make one more point, which, the deputy governor made.
Please,
the former deputy governor. And, you know, it's surprising that it came from a person who was a deputy governor of the RBI. So when demonetization happened, the cash to GDP ratio was around 12%.
Hmm.
It fell to less than 9%. And it has been growing ever since then.
Yes.
And it's now closer to 11%.
Yes.
So there is nothing that suggests that it will again touch 12% in a few years. The other thing that, you know, needs to be countered here is this theory put out by Arvind Subramanian, the former chief economic advisor, who equated, you know, the amount of cash in the economy to the level of corruption, which is very, very, you know, if you look at global data, it's a very stupid point, because, you know, Japan has a cash to GDP ratio of 19% to 20%. Now, Japan is inherently more
less
honest
corrupt
economy than us. Nigeria has, I have some numbers here, Nigeria has a ratio of around 1.85%.
Hmm.
So, you know, cash and you know, amount of cash in the economy has no link to corruption. So,
I also want to point out, the RBI was asked by the parliamentary panel in September 2017 an official estimate of the black money that was extinguished with this move, and the RBI's answer was, there is no information in this regard. So, I'm going to just ask this now, this conversation, I need to move one step further. Mr. Ajay Dua, the question is this: it has been 21 months since demonetization was announced. Aren't the people of India owed an answer, an explanation, a white paper on who advised the government? What research was this entire decision based on? What the final impact was on GDP, on jobs, on black money, on counterfeit currency, whatever it is. Let's have one final word. Why is it that journalists have to use RTI to sort of extract pieces of information and put together a collage of what really happened?
Faye, I would totally agree with you. I've in fact been saying it for a while now, particularly after the RBI governor's evidence before the parliamentary committee, where he could not point out the advantages or the pros and cons of this very major monetary measure. I think even if the goalposts have changed, which normally one should not, the cost which has been paid or incurred by the economy as a whole for these attainments is not commensurate with it at all. It is now for the government to refute these and point out that, all right, we may not have thought of all the possible benefits. There have been certain side benefits of it, as well as maybe certain side ailments or which have cropped up, but whether they were severe or not, that needs to be refuted. Otherwise, public, both informed as well as otherwise, would continue to base itself on anecdotal evidence, as well as the fact that there was a fair amount of press as well as opinions expressed which had pointed out that the government had taken a measure for which it had not done adequate preparations.
Ashutosh ji, I want to take you back to what Vivek Reddy said about the 100 people. Yes, yes. I'll give you all an opportunity. Ashutosh, the 100 people who died, Vivek Reddy said that there will be repercussions or
an increase in the number of taxpayers.
Okay. Ashutosh, go ahead.
I think
25% increase in the number of taxpayers, 50 lakh more taxpayers.
By the BJP spokesperson, it was not only the death of these people, there were many marriages which could not happen, and many people had suffered. And I just failed to understand that why this government is hiding the data of demonetization. And there is a pattern, there's a clear pattern here. The clear pattern is that you cannot know the price structure of the Rafael deal. You cannot know about the farmer's death. There is no data about the farmer's death. You cannot find out the job data from the government. You cannot find the demonetization data. And above all, the CAG report on the defense deals, which you should be on online, even that has also been withdrawn. Now the question is, if the demonetization data people cannot know, there are other five things people can't know. So in a democracy, if the transparency is not there, if the people are not being told what exactly is happening, that means there is something to hide. And that is my question. That is my question. And that's what I began.
Yes, fair enough. Akash Jindal.
The purpose of the demonetization was not what it was spelt out.
Yeah. Akash Jindal, yeah. you and I have had enough of these conversations. Let's just settle on the fact that the government owes us the data and an explanation.
Definitely, the government owes lots of explanation, not only for demonetization, it's for jobs, many other things. BJP has to give us answers. But one small limited point, now RBI perhaps says that black money was in the shape of real estate and gold. If it was like so, now we all know transactions have been capped in cash. Now those people who had money in these illegal assets, black money assets, now they have been penalized. They can't come out of that. So black money has already been hit. That is one point which nobody has, perhaps with due regards, I would say, bothered to answer. Now, supposedly somebody had invested black money into a real estate deal. Subsequent to demonetization, government has capped cash transactions. So how would that person come out? So he has been penalized for doing illegal activities in black money. Secondly, now I have a lot of respect for Kaul Saab, he's a veteran. Now he's saying that Chinese economy is growing at 6% at a sufficient pace. China itself is admitting, sir, that they have suffered severely and yes. They are now making adjustments. According to America, just in order to their economy properly.
Okay, so I only have a minute, so I'll give that minute to Vivek. But I want to focus more than the Chinese economy, because that's derailing us. Akash Jindal, one second.
Doing better than Japan, China, US, and rest of the world. That is a fact which...
All right, I do want to focus just on this transactions being capped in cash. We could have capped transactions without doing demonetization.
Yeah, I mean, which is what I wanted to say.
And to also say that transactions are not happening in cash is a fallacy.
Just because transactions have been capped in cash doesn't mean transactions are not happening in cash. I mean, that's...
We actually, on this channel, did stories post-demonetization, 6 months in... where people were still taking cash, 3 months in where the cash had a going rate.
I can only talk about where I live. I live in central Mumbai, and anyone should try hiring an apartment, at 100% check.
Check.
They will know for sure as to whether transactions are happening in cash or not. So, I mean, just because they've been capped doesn't mean...
So, I just wanted you to bring it back to one of the things. Now, increased tax compliance... the increased, people using bank accounts, less cash being moved in the... following success of Paytm, which is also a happy coincidence for that company after demonetization, and transactions being kept in cash. All of these things could have been done very easily without bringing the country to its knees for 3 weeks. We needn't have gone through demonetization.
Yeah, I mean, there is no link between, increasing the amount of digitization in the economy and, sending all of us on a merry-go-round for a period of a couple of months. So,
all right. So we have run out of time, but like I said, we are owed as a country an explanation. We are owed data. We have to understand, and we have to be told at this point on whose advice the government of India decided to make the decision of demonetization. Who was advising you? What research papers were you referring to? What was that massive need to bring in that surprise decision? There's no longer the need for secrecy, you can tell us now. And we are also owed a white paper on the final impact of demonetization on the GDP, on jobs, on the farm sector, on agriculture, on farmers, on daily wage laborers, on small businesses, on the SME sector, on the real estate sector, on laborers who work in the real estate sector, and so on. If the government wants to tell us that they have found so many thousands of bank accounts with unexplained cash in it, I would like to know, what action have you taken against those people? How many have you prosecuted? How many people have gone to jail for not paying their taxes? And how many people currently are strolling the streets of London wearing ostrich skin jackets and have not been brought to the book? Demonetization was a singular decision that affected all of us. We are owed an explanation. Thanks for watching.